What's up, guys, and welcome to this very, very long video from me, the Scarander, and the wrap up of Live Your League Season 5 with Scandinavian Stoutlands. Before I even start all this, it actually turned out to be a 4-hour ride of material, so all these spells are sped up, and I'm gonna leave a few comments on them. Yes, I'm gonna listen to good music while doing so, but I'm going to, of course, comment on the people that helped me out these matches. Now, we did make it very far, as you guys know. We actually made it to the very, very end, which was incredible. I was so stoked over that. I had no intentions of winning this, which, of course, who has that when you know to come in as a runner-up, basically, and just go into make sure to survive, to cover a team with 3 losses. And the first thing we're gonna do is, of course, watch those 2 losses and the one that is a forfeit against Bogart Sashru. It was a good. The previous owner of this team, Puerto Rican Arcanines, or Grail, very, very powerful trainer, he felt out of it after 2 losses, and he is a good player and really showcased throughout this throughout these battles. But it took a toll on him when he lost both of them, and they're gonna be, like I said, really much sped up. And yeah, I'll hear from you again when I'm entering the fray against Sarah Lucian, so enjoy while you last. And now we are the Scandinavian Stoutlands, and yes, it's still very, very sped up. My opponent here, Talarusin, had a really rough team. I decided to actually sack off 2 Pokemons, or not sack off, but switch out. And that was, he had a Typhlosion and also Hexorus. I decided to bring Dianchi and Stoutland instead. I really needed that. I needed a fairy Pokemon, basically. My team that I had here was not doing well against dragons, and Stoutland was pretty obvious, since Grail actually packed Likes off the power on his team. It felt like a good deal, it really did. And this was basically my first match. Like I said there, I had 3 losses going in, and all I needed here was to play very, very, very aggressive. Now, my Scolipede is an Assault Vest set, a really unique one. It did work very well, this battle. Then again, I had a lot of hacks on my side. And basically, I went really, really, really aggressive. Never played in this format before, I never had this team either. So I had a rough time trying to decide how to play. And I'll say I did fairly this game. There are a lot of weird plays, but at the same time, it's the very same plays that my opponent does that makes it kind of funny to look at, because there's not a whole lot of misplays, but more that there are strange situations here. And I mean, I got burned, I went for Diamond Storm, and due to the burn, I do not kill the Volcarona and has Reflect up in that situation. But the reason the NG is a part of this battle was because of Volcarona and the matchup that the NG won this game. Now, mind you, this is one of the few games where the NG is a part of, because she actually ends up being not a bad Pokemon per se, but there were a lot of things that didn't work well with her, which meant that she was tough for the format and the matchup that were introduced to. So yeah, basically here we do manage to win a 2-0, and yeah, I think I had Espeon on this team too, which actually fought this battle really, really badly, because I got burned with Stoutland of it when I attacked that Volcarona. And Espeon will not be able to take... like, I went from Hydro Pump to soak that out, but a Hydro Pump would critman kill me, which is awful. But like I said, yeah, I had Mega Scizor, Espeon on this team, and they are not... none of them are long-lasting. After a battle against Mr. Murkrow, I decided to cut them, basically, because I couldn't play with him. I had Confagricus too, never used it, so I decided to pretty much sack it. Now, this is the battle against Mr. Murkrow, and like I said there, Espeon did not do a whole lot this battle. It actually gets Pursuit trapped by him, and this is probably the game I designed that the synergy in the team I have been using, it's not what I want, it's not what I can work with, it's actually fairly tough for me to work around, and I needed something different. So the guys that came in after this was Magnezone, because I had a big issue against steel types, and also in general Skarmory was really, really tough for this team to deal with. So I thought that for a sand team, Magnezone is really needed. It has a lot of abilities, makes it worthwhile. And outside of that, I decided, of course, to bring Siglyph. Siglyph has one of the best fail-save you can ask for in a draft system. So it was a very, very curious choice. And I think I ended up Mega Garchomp. Thinking about it hereafter, probably not the best draft by the team that I have. But Mega Garchomp was really fun. I mean, I had a sand team. I thought I could utilize that in contrast to. That didn't actually never happen throughout the league, which was which was funny. But as you guys can see throughout this match, I'm really, really struggling here against Mr. Murkrow, and there is no way I'm gonna win. He got me cornered, and I'm basically switching in and out. The Genji I'm using is a defensive set with Reflect and Light Screen. I was supposed to Baton Pass my Scolipede into Mega Scizor, because that would annihilate his team. But no, that is not how it works. It really, really is a painful to watch this again. Because not only do I play outside of my nature, I do so many wrong plays here that I should die, I should lose. There's no coming back from this, and seeing this battle again makes me realize that. I played much differently later on here in the league due to how awful this match went on. So my second or third game was against, Shiny Sophion. And here is probably the first time in a while where I actually, like, now I'm playing the way I want to. So I have a mana pool, Magnezone, to lock in her Cobalion so she doesn't threat me. And then basically my sack Magnezone, which felt really awful. But at this point I could just go sweeperish with Siglyph. Siglyph is super powerful this battle, hits super hard, Life Orb, Magnet, and all of that, all that jazz. And look, I'm not gonna take any damage lightly here. I basically was sacking off my Powdon to bring, if I remember correctly, Stoutland, just to, you know, here we go, just dent that shit. Like, that was my main idea. I didn't really care for her pressure here, because all I really wanted was to dent a lot of holes in her team, and then basically bring Scolipede, go for a Sword Stance, go for getting a speed boost and all of that, and then later on basically sweep with my Mega Garchomp. And that is exactly what I ending up doing. I am super, super defensive, so there is not a whole lot threatening me. I take the Stone Edge actually fairly well now. Would have been a crit, that would have been unfortunate. But anyway, as you can see, Hitmontop is dancing really well with that. And I've drew the Baton Pass. Now here's the Zaxxus, which got legendary after this battle. Because just after one Sword Stance, one Speed Boost, it's over. She can't stop this. This is it. Like, the Intimidate is cute, but I knew that once her only Pokemon left was Mega Venusaur, I knew that Outrage would at least do it kill with at least one HP behind it. Now, she doesn't pack the Hidden Power Ice, and that's super important. And that's how we got rid of Shiny Sophion and got our first real win with my real team. Now, next match here is against Nick, who took over a team. If I remember correctly, he took over for a guy named Kelly. And my main idea here was to do the same thing against the Shiny Sophion, but that didn't really work. Nick really fend me off well, and Dragon Claw here on my Garchomp was actually hurting really badly on everything on his team, so I had no reason to stop doing so. I actually hurt even the Dewblade quite well. Now I do decide to switch that up there because Dewblade is not a threat for me specifically, and of course the Power Run is just generally doing really well. And here's the Mega Gyarados, which he drafted. A very powerful Pokemon, mind you, but I had ways to go around with it, and of course I decided to go for Roar for, of course, avoiding potential Dragon Dance sweep. And here's the first time I use Chansey too, and you get widely hated. I'm actually not a big fan of Chansey, so I'm not going to try to avoid that circumstance. It's actually a real deal. Chansey is really nice, but I'm not a big fan of it. And of course, you know, I have the Wish Pass, which is awesome, and everything just going well here against Nick. He is not really getting the footing he needs to defeat me as a player. And I guess the game kind of looks like this. It's not a whole lot that's gonna happen. It's actually a really slow game, to be honest. We're gonna speed this up a little bit. Because in the end, all that happens is that I'm successfully able to keep up the sand really, really well, and outside of that, he has nothing that really can hurt Chansey. And on top of that, I wish pass, of course, to my Zaxxus, which, of course, the power that grew in here created the monster, really. It was that simple. Thunderous being scarfed, I do believe, hurts a lot of things. And I do end up eventually, I think, to actually kill or lose my Garchomp, but I am close of actually 6-0 Nick here, which is really bad for him because he played a decent game. It ramped up to being really tough. Now here's the first time Ellis is on board, my co-assistant, because my opponent's team here is really tough. He has Kyurem, he has Heatran, he has Mega Scissor, which I dropped, and of course the Greninja X and Y set, so I'm not the most favorable position here, but I got a few hints and pieces for this game because I needed a win. I needed to kind of... I was still in a relegated area where I could eventually just drop. So I really, really was forced to win this battle, and I had no idea how. So this is what I would probably call the Ellis timeline, actually, where he provided me with a lot of information to do this well, and my opponent actually do not bring, and I say that again, he do not bring the Heatran, which is actually really, really, really tough on my team. And this is actually the first time using Keldeo, hey, what's up? And it did not do a whole lot this battle, surprisingly. Keldeo is actually, I used it really, really badly in the beginning, mostly because I didn't know how to use it, but also I underappreciated the Pokemon overall, and I guess in the end that kind of forced me to play, well, not bad, but I have a lot of missed momentum in my other games where it would have made all the difference, and I'm basically just missing that. But as you guys see here, Gerhardt having a tough time getting footing against me, and you know, for obvious reasons. I do play very, very defensively, and basically I'm using the sand to my advantage and just keep that pressure up, and that's really all I needed, and the direct result of that is that he can't find a footing. And I mean, I take down his Mega Scissor, I take down the Vaporeon before I realize that it has Shadow Sneak on his Greninja, which is a bad on his part. And I do believe I keep going for returns here because I felt that, you know, I got this game in the bag. I don't really need to go out of my comfort zone here anymore. I can just accept my fate. And he's going for a U-turn, it's fine. I basically won this game by default, and I think I ending up sacking my Stoutland in there. That was one of the few times it actually got sacked. And of course, this is actually the first time I'm using Sweeper-based Scaldipede, which is something I should keep doing. And I packed a superpower only for QRM, only for you. And there we go, there is just no going back from this. Shadow Snake will do a decent amount, but Scaldipede will just finish this game just nicely. And that's GG. Wow, Scaldipede, already there, it actually made all kinds of shit on against opponents. And the next game is actually up against Bluesy. Now, Bluesy had a pretty decent team against me. Like, it had a lot of plays it could have made. I basically needed to use my analytic Magnezone to log in his Bronzong, and then from there, actually, setting up the sand and win with Stoutland. And this was actually all me. I had a solid strategy against my opponent here. And also had Protect on Stoutland in case his Mega Lugpunny wanted to go for High Jump Kicks. So this is probably one of the most anticlimactic battles ever, because there is really, and I'm gonna be honest, I really see my opponent really struggling throughout this match. There is just not a lot happening, and of course it sets up Reflect, which means I do a very, very little damage on the Umbreon. Now that is fine on its own, because we are having a nice stall out, and I think I kept going for paralyzation just to keep him paralyzed. And now here comes the Flygon, which is really, really fine. I have Rocky Helmet here just to catch it on the switch out and get my rocks up and get the sand up. So basically now I am really, really dangerous. And here's Flygon back on, it's gonna go for EQ, that's fine. I went for Slack Off, scouting the damage. Now, I think I thought he would go for another Earthquake, which he didn't. And my Mephos ends up to hurt really, really badly. Definitely not how you should use, a Sigilyph like that. That was a bad switch, I should have just kept slacking off, really. Since he had a life orb, I could just stole him out. So anyway, here is the Sylveon. Now, Sylveon possess actually some kind of threat here, so I actually decided to sack off Sigilyph eventually. And here I can bring Stoutland and actually return it and kill it. And this is answer just subsides. And here is, of course, a Mokka. And here's the situation. I go for Protect, go for High Jump Kick. It's basically dead. Switch out to Chansey, and he misses the High Jump Kick. So that is so anticlimactic. That's it's still funny, though. It's really funny. And there is just nothing he can do here. He's lost by default, basically. He will try to defeat me with his Umbreon, but you know, it's all over. It's a very, very nice 5-0 that we pull off here. And like I said there, actually it's a 4-0, I lost Magnezone too. But as I said, I had a lot of good ideas going into this game, and I knew exactly what I needed to do to defeat my opponent, and Bluesy paid a very high price for that, considering that my setup actually worked really well. Now this is probably one of the more awkward games against Green Scrafty Rudy, because the thing is here, I don't know what I was thinking. I thought I would outspeed a Roaster Raid, but I was actually a more defensively built set, so it actually, he outspeeded me with 4 points, which was super, super awkward. So we do manage to paralyze the Charizard, which is really nice, and the Sandstorm pretty much kills the Charizard, and this is probably one of the roughest time, really, I see a Charizard go down. He's gonna bring the Milotic, and as of now, I pretty much won. It's one of the few instances where, like, when the Charizard was gone, it was just, that was GG. There was no way he was gonna come back from that. And, you know, I got the sand on my own, I could just bring in Stoutland, and the game was over. So a lot of Stoutland strategies was going here. And as you guys know, there is only one way to go against Azumarill, that is never to switch out on it. And of course it went for a potential Belly Drum, which did not pay off. And here's the Slim Shady, and yes, I can't do anything against it, but he can also don't do anything against the Yanchi, so I used it 3 times then. Ha! I see. I think I had the Yanchi for the Charizard, actually. so it couldn't spam Outrage. Now I think about it, I have Earth Power. And if that was the case, that he was forced out and go for... Basically, this was a failsafe, much like Sigilyph usually plays. So anyway, my opponent here will eventually forfeit, because it comes down to that situation that he can't do anything against anything on my team. And it's kind of brutal. I think I win this game 5-0 or something like that, which really, really, really sucks. Because Rudy is a much better battler, he just had a rough time against me. And here is probably the funniest game I had. I did forfeit against the D-Train before going into this though, but here's against the Team Monkeys, or Tactical Monkeys, and I was so drunk in this battle. This was one of the few cases where I didn't really need to win at all. I went into this game with only one mindset. I had a stream, and I think now it was close to 10 p.m. or anything like that, and on a Saturday, mind you. And obviously, yeah, we can just have that battle over with, I don't care. And it turned out to be a very, very nice battle, because I play super weird this battle. I do a lot of weird plays, I do what I feel like, and it ending up working actually quite well. And I felt really bad for my opponent, mostly because he needed a win to stay in his lead. It was a cross division match, I guess you'd say. And let's just say that had Verlet not be, or Verlet's replacer, Ghost to Hunt, been unobtainable and actually been kicked out of the league, then this battle would have actually destroyed Tactical Monkey's record and actually kicked him off the league. So it was actually really funny. I really, really say that, but I don't often play good when I'm drunk, and this is not me playing good, this is me playing extremely reckless, and it's paying off, like, a lot. So alright, then of course Stoutland's gonna come in. I think this is like, yeah, let's do it, let's pop some things. That was all I thought, like, yeah, bring Stoutland, and as long as the sand is going, I should win. I only have one strategy that should work for everything, all the time. Like I said, I felt really bad for my opponent, because he's not doing anything wrong. It's just me being super, super reckless, and it pays off so goddamn much. So, Tactical Monkeys, if you're watching this battle, I'm really sorry about this game in general, and I really, really hope that you found this battle as good as I did, because I sure as hell did. I thought it was incredibly funny. Now, the next match is a forfeit from Bogot Sandshrew, which is actually the second time there's a forfeit between us. Obviously, I was unobtainable or not on the team at that part, but we're going actually against, in semifinals, against Mr. Murkrow. And this was really scary. This was probably when it all really started going down. And I actually sped down these battles a little bit, because I do want to talk about them a little more. The sack here was really, really necessary. I had a Hidden Power Flying, and I needed to break apart the Superior if it would even have a chance. Him. This was the first time I'm playing serious against Mr. Murkrow. I mean, this is the first time I'm using the complete team against him, yes. We also have a situation where, and this is one of the ones going to stand out, that I wasn't going for hours. I had a real plan. Ellis Forget really helped me out here, restructurized myself. Koba Berry, Kelio, such a champ. And basically, I had switch-ins, I had ideas, I had a structure, which was something I never had before. And I think Ellis really did bring it to me, like, this is how we gotta play, this is the only way you can win against him. And the matchup was not too shabby. I had a few Pokemon I could switch in and out on, and the only thing I really needed to do was to be the better player. And obviously, since I went through this battle eventually, and going against the division final, I was actually the better player for once. Like I said, Mr. Murkrow did 6-0 me, and while I was not prepared in that battle and had Pokemon I was not that comfortable with, it finally broke down. And I think that was the third time I used my Garchomp, and it just falled. I actually had to sack that Pokemon to get a better position. I'm not a big fan of sacking Pokemon, but that was the thing, I needed to win the matchup. I didn't care for preserving Pokemon, nobody cares about that. At least not in these kind of matches. It was only about getting momentum. And I think I did that just fine this game. Scarlet Pete playing a major role really in this battle, and I was switching in and out every time against the freaking Talonflame. Talonflame was such a threat this battle, it was the only thing stopping my Scarlet Pete. And actually Scarlet Pete was probably the only thing stopping his whole team outside of Talonflame. So he was really scared of that throughout this match, I do believe. So anyway, here's one of the other situations. I had a pretty heavily special defensive power down, only because in case that they brought a specially oriented Toxicroak, so I knew I was gonna live a potential Focus Blast, which was incredibly funny. Ellie said I only needed to settle for 104 special defense. I decided, you know what, I need to go 232, so I at least can take a 50%-ish hit from a Focus Blast. So I was really glad that I wasn't in that position. And now I got a sack off. Of course, the Hippowdon. And as of right now, you know, things are rough. Things are really rough. I need to bring the Scaldipede yet again, and he's gonna switch out on it and bring the Mustang, and I'm gonna bring Keldeo, because I was hoping that he was gonna Brave Bird himself to death, but he's actually gonna roost up, which actually doesn't bother me at all, because he will go for the Brave Bird and Cobaberry after all this time, always. And of course he's gonna go for Brave Bird, and I survive it, and I'm gonna scald it to death, and that is GG. It's really, really funny how unfortunate Mr. Murkrow was, because this was actually a very tough way of him going down, because it have me planning this game all over it, or not me, Ellis of course provided that would be the best set to work out of, and basically all I wanted was fail save for Talonflame. I had four Pokemon who did defeat Talonflame 1-1, and eventually did pay off. Now, the next match is the division final, and since it is kind of recent, I'm just gonna play that through really fast. And this battle also is heavily credited to Ellis for the sets and the things we were thinking about, because D-Train was actually probably the battler who was going to beat me. I had such a bad matchup against his entire team. I was actually forced to only use 6 of my 10 Pokemon for actually one reason. Everything in his team beats everything in my team flawlessly. I was so sure I was gonna get beaten, but he actually did not decide to go for a rain team, which made his battle a bit more easier for me. It's still a tough game, but I mean, had he gone for a rain team and an offensive Seismitoad, things would have been super ugly, and that was something I did not want to go for. So I am very aggressive in this battle. I was really trying to force David or Z-Train to play defensively, because that was actually my only response to his complete team, which wow, I can't believe I won this game eventually. I can't. I had a lot of luck, of course, and I had a lot of like Landers, who was probably my primary suspect for like the toughest matchup, was probably the only Pokemon that I designed my whole team against. I mean, I have Magnuson with Airbloom for that very reason alone. And actually, I did the Poltergeist to take out the Seismitoad too, yes. Outside of that, Magnuson just came through here this game. Basically because it took so much damage, but also that D-Train actually... he did let me get the analytic boost. He tried to set up with the Gligar, which... He paid a very high price for that, and I still feel bad about it, because I have to address this, that had he not done that play, he might not have win due to my Sigilyphian Focus Sash, but that was a very tough call to make. It really was, and of course I even score a freeze here in the end, just to really rub it in on the D-Train. And his only attack move with the Gligar was actually EQ, which would have basically meant that I won by default. So now it's the last game. And the last game was rough. If you guys have seen it, then you have exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, had I played it risky here, I would have won. If I didn't leave my Sigilyph in here, I wouldn't have lost my Sash. It's a lot of those things that happened this game that just... Oh, it's so tough to see. I didn't have to go for Heatwave there to set up his Gust Up barrier. I suspected that it could have been a thing. And yeah, she just got her Ice Beam from the beginning. And here's Landorus taking it out, and that's fine. And now I'm gonna bring Keldeo, and Keldeo is gonna sub up. And that's one very nice situation. I had a very nice situation going here. and I went for Sacred Sword, and I didn't realize how low roll I got there. And the next Sacred Sword with the reduced, without the reduced parry damage, would have taken it out. I did not act on it, and I did not realize that the Terra Bolt actually taking care of my Volt Absorb. But the worst part was just that thing that was skipped there, and that was that I didn't taunt this Cloyster. And you get a crit Hydro Pump on me. So there are a lot of things here happening, but I have at least one more try to beat him, and that is go for Protect with Scaldipede, but don't do that. I was thinking that he would go for another Shell Smash. Had I gone for, I can't believe it, had I gone for another round of that, I probably would have won the match anyway, because I still got the Mega Garchomp left, and yes, he had Will-O-Wisp, sure, but I have Sword Stance on both of my sweepers. And that will wrap up this season. So yeah, we actually, I mean, come on, I'm still like the Seta champion, and that's really, really, really cool, and probably not as deserving as I made it out to be, and I'm really proud of that, I really am. And my last game here, yes, I do so many weird plays that I should not win. There are a lot of things that did not go down, and I have to comment on my opponent there, Tipster Jonas, who was my last opponent from, and the Delta champion, for playing it really, as he deserved that win for playing it the way he should have played it. I was really frustrated over that. I had control over that game. I actually had responses to it, but I didn't act on it, and it was a rough way of losing. I should have definitely, you know, paused a little bit and just really, really start thinking. I made 3 major, even 4 major mistakes in my last game, and when I say major, I mean that I had the right feeling on them. I had a lot of fail-saves for everything went sour, and I just said he didn't do it, and it was so bad. It was such a rough loss. But you know, that's actually really okay. It was one hell of a ride, and I had a lot of fun this season, and I'm looking forward to the next one. And like I said, major thanks to the players that helped me out. Friquette, Ellis, especially in the playoffs, this guy was a monster. He saw so many good things that could go down. And then we have, of course, the Ashton UK, Eric, who helped me so much too. He really, really made a difference. A lot of good thought process with him, and he's a generally good battler. I had a lot of fun juggling ideas with him, and I think he had hopefully the same idea about me, that we helped each other out throughout this. And yeah, those two really stand out. Like I said, Ellis, if you make it back to next season, then you guys are in trouble. I'm going back for that Lithio League title. I mean, I always say that, you know, I'm a good gut feeling player in general, but I'm not the guy with the plan. And if I have a guy with the plan behind me, with me doing the good plays, obviously not in the last one, then you guys are in trouble. You guys are going down. And I'm really looking forward to next season. And this is actually the first time I get the chance to draft on my own. And I have a few ideas on what I want to create. So yeah, you guys better watch out. So I want to thank everybody for all the support. It's been an incredible ride with all of you. And to the Lithio, the league, guys, thank you so much for making me a part of this. Since I didn't actually make to the real league, I actually went out to the semifinals, I believe, there. Was not as good of a battler as I am now. I just really wanted to say thank you, guys. That has been an incredible ride. And I hope next season will be just as good. And yes, like I said, the title is mine next year, definitely. So I'll set up a Seta champion for now. Okay, guys, I hope you liked this. It's a very lengthy video. So if you stayed all the way, then kudos on that. And yeah, just in general, guys, thank you so goddamn much. And I see you next season. Until then, guys, take care. Bye.